Joe McDonald, there he is right there. Joey Mack, what were your impressions when you saw Donato there entering with the bells and whistles, I guess?
Well, Jameson, if I knew these guys were going to be wearing their holiday suits tonight, I would have worn my holiday onesie, but I don't think it fits me anymore because the last time I wore it, I was probably 10 years old, and that was a long time ago.
Yeah, and I know the Bruins do put up a nice spread there on the ninth floor with the desserts after period one, too. So don't worry, all the suits in Boston fit a little bit tighter. But getting back to the action tonight, Joey Mack, the Bees and the Ducks, they've both been snake-bitten by injuries this season. You think that changes the way either of these two teams play tonight with that holiday break approaching?
Yeah, Jameson, when you think about it, when you look at these two teams, this is going to be the 35th game of the season for the Bruins and the 37th for the Anaheim Ducks. And combined, entering tonight's game, they have 348 man games lost. That's just insane when you think about it. And you're talking some big-time names. You're talking, there were so many, I actually had to write them down. You're talking guys like Corey Perry, Patrick Eves, Cam Fowler, Ricard Raquel, you know, Ryan Miller. On Boston side, you have Patrice Bergeron, Zdeno Chara, Kevin Miller, and Jake DeBrus. So those are some big key members that are out of both of their lineups. And the way that these teams have to come in here tonight, they have to have that blue-collar mentality, right? I mean, this is a situation where work ethic has to take priority over the skill level in situations like this. As far as the Bruins are concerned, they got some good news today. It looks like Patrice Bergeron is very close, according to Coach Bruce Cassidy. It's a possibility that he could be back in the lineup as early as Saturday, which would obviously be a huge boost for the Boston Bruins. But without a doubt, these two teams have been depleted by injuries, so it's going to be interesting to see what kind of grind-out, gut-wrenching game tonight here at TD Garden is going to be.
All right, going to be a big one for Chris Wagner facing his former team for the first time since signing with the Bees this summer. How much is he looking forward to tonight's game?
Yeah, this is kind of cool, Jameson, because you figure here's a kid that grew up, you know, a saucer pass away from TD Garden down in Walpole, and he grew up playing youth hockey here, and he gets drafted by the Ducks in 2010 in the fifth round. He's played against the Bruins in this building, but playing against the team that drafted you in your hometown rink is pretty exciting for any player. And when the Bruins signed him, and look, we all know that there are certain players, professional athletes, that can play in front of the hometown crowd and others that can't. Chris Wagner so far this year for the Boston Bruins has proven that he is that type of player. He's a bottom six forward. He adds that grit that the Bruins were kind of looking for. He kills penalties, and Bruce Cassidy isn't afraid to put him on the ice late in game situations. So it's going to be fun for Chris Wagner tonight playing for his hometown team against a team that drafted.
The last couple of games have been fun for a guy named David Krejci, playing some of his best hockey of the season right now. What does that mean for the Bruins, especially with Patrice Bergeron being that close to coming back?
Exactly, Jameson. When you think about David Krejci, for the entire season he's been good, but as of late, when he's been playing with David Pastrnak and Brad Marchand, Krejci has 7 points in the last 10 games, and you can tell that that line is really gelling, and that's what the Bruins need at this point. What's interesting is when Bergeron comes back, you know that Bruce Cassidy is going to put Bergeron back with his line mates with Pastrnak and Marchand because, look, went together, that line is probably one of the best in the NHL. So it's going to be interesting to see what David Krejci does after Bergeron comes back. And after the holiday roster freeze, now that you see that David Krejci with world-class players, how he can perform, I wonder if Don Sweeney decides to go out and acquire that top six forward that everybody has been talking about here in Boston. But David Krejci, after Bergeron comes back, will be reunited when Jake DeBrus is healthy, and it's a matter of who they put on that opposite side to find a good compliment for David Krejci. But without a doubt, as of late, he's been one of the best Bruins players here.
All right, the Bees will have their hands full tonight. The Ducks have won 9 straight in this matchup. Joey Mack, this is your official notice. Next time on Arena Cam, we want your best holiday suit, okay?
No birthday suits.
No, please. For our viewers' sake, for our burning eyes, no. Nobody wants that. Appreciate it, Joey Mack. See ya. Kristen Anderson, the Flames have been one of the best teams in the NHL so far this season. And tonight they'll face arguably the top team in the league, in the Lightning. What was some of the reaction from the guys today about tonight's game?
Well, the Calgary Flames are coming off probably one of their least impressive efforts to date, a 2-0 loss at Dallas on Tuesday. And this is a huge measuring stick for this group, who is trying to prove that they're elite as well. The Tampa Bay's, like you mentioned, is absolutely crushing the National Hockey League this year with points in 10 consecutive games and a 9-0-1 run in that span. The Flames want to be elite, and this is the type of the team they want to be this year. And they've been on a roll too, especially at home with an 11-3-2 record, but they need to continue to prove that they can hang with the best in the NHL. Now, heading towards the Christmas break for the NHL is always a little bit of a distraction. The Flames have two games before the break begins, and so they want to put their foot on the gas pedal and really get it done and prove that they can hang with the Lightning tonight.
All right, one big reason for the Flames' success this season is what you call their Fab Five. What stat stands out to you about this key group of Flames?
Yeah, the Fab Five, it's really been interesting the way that their production has come this year, and you have to look at their top line in Johnny Gaudreau, Sean Monahan, and Elias Lindholm. All three of those guys are on pace for career seasons, especially Sean Monahan, who already has 20 goals. It's been an incredible year for him, and you have to look at Elias Lindholm, the acquisition of him in the offseason with the trade in the Dougie Hamilton deal from Carolina. So Elias Lindholm has really added a nice piece, a nice dimension to that top line, and then you look at Matthew Tkachuk. Ka-ching, can you say that? A little bit louder. Like, this guy is going to get paid in the off season. He's in a contract year and already has 40 points. It's truly been a good year for Matthew Tkachuk, who's in the last year of his entry-level deal. And then, of course, Mark Giordano. He looks to be back in his form that he was at, you know, 2 years ago, probably, or even more than that, sorry, 2013-15, when he had a Norris-caliber season that year. So Mark Giordano, Sean Monahan, Elias Lindholm, Johnny Gaudreau, and Matthew Tkachuk, who's also their first power play line, and they've been the most successful of that of the power play units, and they sit, they're the reason why the Flames sit 10th in power play production this year. So it's really been a case of some pretty heavy offensive firepower. Although they were shut out in Dallas, you can expect to see probably a bounce back effort tonight against the Lightning.
From here on out, he's known as Matthew Ka-ching. I like that, until he gets paid. You mentioned Mark Giordano in that Fab Five. Why does he have a case for the Norris Trophy right now?
Yeah, sometimes Mark Giordano gets overlooked, I think, obviously being in the West and you know, he doesn't get a lot of love from the East. But I was talking to Bill Peters about this a few weeks ago, who had spent a lot of time in the East as coach of the Carolina Hurricanes. They know about Mark Giordano. You know, he's not a secret anymore, his type of play. And as I mentioned, that 2014-15 season, that he was kind of on pace playing with TJ Brody for a Norris to get some votes at least. If that year before he tore his biceps tendon in February, so he was out for the rest of the season. But you look at his points, you look at his plus minus, which has improved drastically since last season. He's the heart and soul of this team. I think everybody in the West kind of knows that about Calgary. But Mark Giordano has really, you know, and he even said, you know, it's not always about the points, but it's about the timely points and, you know, his effect on this team as a whole. And he's really been one of the backbones for this group.
All right. He's having a tremendous season. So are the Flames, and they'll get a good test tonight. The measuring stick game against the Bolts. Puck dropping in that one a little bit later. Kristen, thank you very much.
Thanks for having me on.
Hal Gill, Preds radio analyst, joining us on the program right now. Hal, the injury bug, as I mentioned, continues to hit the Preds. Colton Sissons, he's going to miss tonight's game. How have the Preds been able to weather the storm and continue to be one of the top teams in the league despite all these big names going down?
Yeah, they've lost a lot of key players, not just, you know, the third and fourth liners, but missing Arvidsson has been, you know, always drives the team and is great on the forecheck, great around the net. Forsberg, who can score at any time. Of course, Subban on defense. They missed Turris for a while, and he's back in the lineup, which really helps settle out the lineup. But it's tough. Now Sissons, he's been playing some fantastic hockey, and he's a tough guy to miss. But they've had guys step up, guys like Hartman, guys like Salamaki. You know, even Rocco Grimaldi's played some great hockey. So they've had guys step up. but it's getting tough. It's been a long time with these injuries. It's making it tough now.
Some good news, though. P.K. Subban and Victor Arvidsson have been skating with the team as they try and work their way back from those injuries that you mentioned. When might we see those guys back in game action?
That's a tough question. I think they might be getting close to ready. There's one more game before Christmas in Boston. Do you bring them back early and try and get them in for one game? Or maybe it's better to give them a little bit more rest and make sure everything's good. And then after Christmas, they can join the team. I'm not sure what the decision will be. It's a tough one. You want to manage those injuries well and make sure that they don't linger around for the rest of the season.
Despite being tied for first place out west, why the Preds struggled on the road this season, currently mired in an 8-game road losing skid?
Yeah, it's tough. At first, it was defensive zone struggles. They couldn't take care of the puck in their own end. And then they figured that out, and then it became neutral zone. They played against Ottawa and got beat up bad in the neutral zone. That's what Ottawa will do to you. In Chicago, last game on the road, they really couldn't get pucks to the net. They couldn't get those grade A scoring chances. Cam Ward played well, but I don't think they did really too much to change the angle and get traffic in front of them. So it's been a mixture of things, and they're still working on it.
Big night tonight in Philly. Our colleague Scott Hartnell going to be honored tonight there before the game. You have any good stories about Hartsey that you can share that are suitable for television?
Suitable for television is a tough one. But you know what? It's overall just a passion for the game. He's dropping the puck tonight. And, a lot of people would just go out there and drop the puck. But he's challenging Roman Josi and Claude Giroux to take the face-off seriously. So it's little things like that. He's always a character. It's so hard to play against, but a lot of fun to play with.
He's 20 years old, and as Rupper made mention earlier, so much pressure on him.
Yeah.
What a start. Two starts, two wins, and as you point out, they were roaring.
Listen.
What a start.
I'm a huge Rocky fan.
Oh,
everybody is, right?
Here we go.
Here's my little rant. You're in the city. They got the statue. It's amazing. I want to go. I want to see it. I've seen it. Everyone wants to go take a picture of it. We know that that's not real, right, in Philly? Well, know who is real? This kid should get a statue right next to Rocky.
Yes.
If this ends up panning out, because that pressure is real, and you can feel the exhale right now from the crowd in those games, the players, that he's looking like he's living up to the tail right now. This could be something really fun to be watching the rest of the season.
Yeah, I just watching him again. I mean, having a good enough sample size based on his games in junior, based on the World Juniors. I didn't get to see him in Lehigh in the American League, but these two starts in Philly, there's a common theme. He doesn't chase the game. He doesn't chase the game. And I can't tell you how hard that is as a young goalie that has a lot of talent and raw skill to not chase the game. Your tendency is to really almost overtry. You want to make the save. You want to bail guys out. You want to be a star. You want to do all those things. And for him, he's doing it in a way that's really measured.
Mm.
And that, to me, is a sign of his maturity in his approach, like we talked about, but also his reads. And now you're making those reads against Johansson, Josi,
President's Trophy winners.
Exactly. You're making those reads against them. A lot of times you're hemmed into the D zone. And I like the fact that he was also able to regain his feet a lot, which we pointed out a little bit earlier in the broadcast, regain his feet, present himself to the shooters under control, great balance, and great control over his skates to allow him to go to the save selection he wants. Very impressive so far.
More fun and weirdness for you on NHL Tonight. It's time for the NHL Hat Trick Challenge presented by Enterprise. With Kevin Weeks, I'm Steven Nelson. Three questions. Previewing the games on Friday, Weeksy. Okay. Are you ready?
Yeah, born ready. Let's go.
Let's dive right
Holiday
in.
Season.
Question numero uno. Will the Buffalo Sabres...
Do it.
I don't like it.
Reset. Reset.
Score on the power play against Washington.
Come on now. Of course. Buffalo Sabres, the way that top line's playing. Jack Eichel out of Boston. Of course, Eichel's been a man possessed. He's playing great hockey. I love their pieces. I certainly love what Phil Housley's done with that group in the offseason by their general manager in Jason Botterill. They're snapping the puck around, making plays, keeping the opposing team on their heels and having to make tough defensive reads. So I'll say yes.
Question number two.
Oh, yeah.
Easy one. Just pick a winner between the Senators and the Devils.
I'm going to go with the Devils. Sens have played really well this year, exceeded expectations. But the Devils coming off of a difficult loss in Columbus. Close on the score sheet. Mackenzie Blackwood was excellent in that game. And I think the Devs are going to win this one. They've got to start turning the ship around, but
for real,
it's going to be up to them. I spoke to Travis Ajak, said, we got to play the style that we played last year. The question is, will they? But all that being said, I'm going with the Devs on this one.
Jonathan Toews, if you think way back to when he debuted with the Hawks, his first big highlight came against the Colorado Avalanche. Just a beauty of a goal. Well, on Friday, Hawks Avs, will Jonathan Toews score at least one?
They're coming off a big victory, and Jonathan Toews is playing really well offensively this year. You know all the intangibles that he brings to the table and the complete game, but his offense is back to where it should be. And for all those reasons and more, I'm going to say yes. He's regained his confidence. He's regained his touch. He's more assertive in the O-zone. So I say he gets one.
Okay, so the Sabres are scoring on the power play against the Caps. You're picking the Devils to win, and Jonathan Toews will get one, at least one, against the Avs. Tomorrow on Friday, those are Weeksy's picks. You can play NHL Hat Trick Challenge daily for the chance to win the $20,000 regular season grand prize, and until January 25th for your chance to win the $10,000 period two prize.
Hot on ice. Austin Matthews, so hot right now, like Hansel. 2-2. Two goals, two assists, seventh multi-goal game this season. That's a stunning number considering the time he's missed. He's at the top of the league in that category. We all marvel at his game, the strength, the grace, and the numbers speak for themselves. Leading the league in multi-goal games with Alex Ovechkin. Ovi's played a dozen more games. How do you explain it?
He's really good.
Yeah, exactly.
He's
that's
great.
Analysis.
He's really fun. He's really fun to watch. And the thing I like about him, that I really like about him, is he has this kind of stoic presence to him. But when he scores, I grew up loving Pavel Bure scoring because I felt like when Pavel Bure would get his 47th goal as an empty net goal or his 21st goal or his third goal, he was fist pumping and screaming and yelling. He's passionate. We see Ovi do that. We see the great goal scorers do that. So although Austin Matthews looks very calm and very stoic in the way he does things, he's passionate when he scores goals.
Yes,
man. He loves scoring goals.
Yeah.
And you see it on a nightly basis.
Yeah, and like all the greats, he's able to score goals. Or not all, but the majority of the greats, he scores goals in different ways.
Yeah.
And that's one of the things about Ovi. We look for him to score from the Ovi office, but he doesn't just score from there. Austin Matthews has shown, if you look at a heat map of where he scores from, he scores strong side, weak, offside, middle of the ice, in and around the net. He can tuck it from anywhere. The one where he grabbed the puck out of midair that we showed.
Oh, it was amazing.
A lot showed.
Amazing.
He's just
an athlete.
Yeah, he's so fun to watch. I love watching Awesome, as I call him. Awesome Matthews. I love watching him play.
Phenomenal, man.
I call him Austin Powers. Yeah, baby, yeah. He's amazing.
He is.
He definitely
From
is.
Night one.
Yeah.
Hit him with the four, and it's been amazing ever since.
Kit Kat to start it off.
Yeah.
Take it. Yep.
Break me off a piece of that Kit Kat bar.
Nice.
It is time for the Enterprise Pickup of the Week. I'm Steven Nelson with the man, the myth, the legend, Kevin Weeks, and we're highlighting two players, one from each conference. Weeksy, it's your show.
Yeah, we'll start in the West because I love doing that. Just know that we're
the best coast.
Exactly. We're going to give you your love out there. So let's go Denver. And I really love what Rantanen has done so far this season. He's been outstanding, arguably the best player in the league this year. Incredible. The production rates are something that we weren't even expecting to be this high, but they've shot through in terms of his offensive production. He's been a superstar for head coach Jared Bednar. And on the left, one of the best players in the history of the game, Alexander Ovechkin. No slowing down, no cup hangover, none of that silly talk. He's just been dominant so far this season. Both these guys, two offensive wizards, and they're a lot of fun to watch.
The Great Eight and Miko, don't you know that they are the pickups of the week, presented by Enterprise and the NHL Hat Trick Challenge. So download the NHL Hat Trick Challenge app, or you can play online at hattrick.nhl.com for your chance to win cash prizes and NHL tickets. Rent, buy, or share. How can Enterprise pick you up today? clutch performance of the night presented by Bridgestone, and it goes to Carter Hart. Fellas, we got the question from Stephen Philly Birds on Twitter. What did you think of Carter Hart's performance tonight? Weeksy, we'll start with you.
I thought he was composed once again. He was patient. He was in the spots. He did a great job of pushing forward, as he does here, to take away angle. That's an innate ability that I've noticed with him. His game recognition and his situational awareness and reads so far have looked very NHL-esque in only two starts. So when you've got that composure and you have a skill set, but when you can read the game like I've seen in these first two starts, he doesn't look at all. Let me say, he looks very comfortable. He looks as comfortable as he did playing in Everett in the WHL, playing for Team Canada in the World Juniors, and he looks every bit that comfortable so far in this small sample size. I've been very impressed by him. The poise, the patience, and the reads have been spot on.
Yeah, that's one thing, and I go back to that one play we spoke about earlier when he goes down on a short-range shot. He goes down, takes away the low ice, makes the save, and then there's a short rebound again. And not just staying down, committed to the first save, back to his feet, and comes out to challenge the angle again on the second shot. So I don't know if that's – that to me is – if it's instinctual, if it's just the repetition of doing it, but at the end of the day, he's doing exactly what makes it difficult on a score to score on him. It's pretty good when you're a goaltender. So he looks fantastic.
He definitely does.
New hashtag on the board. Yeah. Hart trophy. Not an actual trophy, but the clutch performance of the night. That's something for Carter Hart.
I like it.
I'm feeling it.
Yes.
I'm feeling a break. Bonus coverage is coming your way on the network of NHL, and it's a good one. The Sharks and the Jets at the Shark Tank. Stick with us. What else we got?
Nice. Whoa. That's a whole squad.
They don't need suits. They have cat sweaters.
Yep. As a cat owner, I love that.
Bridgestone tires are built to come through in the clutch, just like NHL players.
Time for your three stars of the night. Third star goes to Carey Price, who earned his 300th career win with a 36-save performance in the desert. He joined Jacques Plante as the only goalies in Habs history with 300 wins. Second star goes to Nikolaj Ehlers with a three-goal night, the fourth of his career in Winnipeg's 5-3 win over the Sharks. It's his second hat trick of the season. First star is Austin Matthews, who had 4 points, including a pair of goals in the Leafs' win against Florida. Matthews now has 7 multi-goal efforts in 21 games played.
Ladies and gentlemen, Scott Hartnell.
In the Hartnell way right there.
Exactly.
Drew fires, Scott!
Fans are certainly getting into ugly sweater theme night.
Foligno takes the pass. He's Blackwood and scores.
Tick, tack, goal.
Josh Mahura off the faceoff. First NHL goal.
Appleton has his first NHL goal.
And for Carey Price, welcome to the 300 Club.
The coil at center. Wild could have numbers here at the Pittsburgh line. Greenway scores! A quick wrist shot beats DeSmith from long range, and Greenway has his sixth of the year.
Well, that was a rocket of a shot.
Drops it back. Savard with a shot. Came off the end board! Out, and Blackwood make the save! Yes! As he denies Wenberg at the side of the net.
Terrific job by Mackenzie Blackwood.
Good support from the Flyers, though. They get the puck to McDonald across to Gudas. Gudas shots and rebound. Couturier, the pass, and they score! Voracek ramming it home as Couturier set him up. It's 1-0 Flyers. A lot of players would have tried to shoot there if they were Couturier, but he saw Voracek and gave him the slam dunk.
Here's Getzlaf closing over to Montour. What a save by Jaroslav Halak. Jaroslav Halak had only one option. That was to dive at the puck, and he grabs it with a trapper.
Puck is loose. Jordan Staal. Jordan Martinook. Back for Staal. Offhand. Staal shot. Stop. Rebound. Stays out. A scramble, a stop by Bernier. The puck will leak through. It goes off Erickson. What a play by Philip Hronek.
Kapanen left it for Riley. Morgan Riley back for Matthews. Scores!
So how about this pass? Right in the wheelhouse for Austin Matthews.
And that one-timer was a cannon of a shot.